king of beasts, the lion is the last animal you'd expect to be in trouble. But under attack from all sides, the lion is in danger of losing his kingdom. In the early 1990s, we thought at least 100,000 lions still roamed Africa. But after a recent recount, scientists were shocked to find the number was lower, much lower. The lion's story is one of conflict and controversy. He has many enemies, but also allies battling to save him. What will it take to keep this king on his throne? Big cat expert Jonathan Scott has been studying the lions of Kenya's Masai Mara Game Reserve for almost 30 years.
I think this is most people's idea of wild Africa, lions lying here relaxed in long grass. I think it's come as a real wake-up call for people to find that there could be no more than 30,000 wild lions in Africa. Like many people, I've been lulled into a sense of security by watching lions in protected areas where they do very well. And so it came as a shock to me when word began to pass around that lions weren't doing as well as we thought.
30,000 is optimistic. There could be as few as 16,000 lions left. So what's gone wrong? There was once a time when this majestic beast had a much greater kingdom. It hunted across most of North America, Africa, Southern Asia, and Europe. Slowly, their numbers shrank, and today, South and East Africa is their last great stronghold. Considered vermin, lions and other predators have been eradicated for farming and for fun. From the early 1900s, Africa was the place for the rich and the royal to go hunting. There was nothing more glamorous than a safari. It was disastrous for lions. Around Kenya's Masai Mara, the carnage continued until the 1970s.
Tour operators were complaining, we can't find big male lions, as we used to in the old days, to show visitors. So it was a serious problem. The big males were being taken out, and it was way beyond the capacity of the lions to recover from that.
In a bid to save Africa's spectacular wildlife, vast protected wilderness areas were created across Africa. The Mara Serengeti Reserve is so vast, zebra and wildebeest can complete their 1,000-mile annual migration between Tanzania and Kenya. With such huge protected areas, the lion's future seemed assured. So why have their numbers continued to decline? One of the prime suspects was disease. Could an epidemic have swept through Africa, decimating its lions? Over the last 10 years, there's been some disturbing evidence. The first signs of trouble came in February 1994. Witnessed by tourists on a balloon ride over the Serengeti in Tanzania. The scene below must have looked idyllic. But not far from the banks of the Serengeti River, the tourists spotted something out of the ordinary. they noticed a lion behaving strangely. He appeared disoriented, kept convulsing, and was clearly very sick. It wasn't long before he died. And this was not a solitary case. This mystery illness spread like wildfire. Another peculiar thing was happening. Lions within a pride seemed to be fighting each other to the death.
People began to wonder what was going on, and it turned out that animals that were sick were acting unusually. And of course, these animals are very sensitive to anything that's untoward in their environment. And if you're my pride mate and you start acting oddly, I'm going to think, hey, something's wrong here. And I might attack you just simply because I feel threatened.
Scientists were puzzled by the symptoms, but when they received test results, they were amazed that the illness the lions were suffering from was one more commonly seen in another animal, the domestic dog. The illness was identified as canine distemper, a deadly airborne virus that can be lethal to dogs and lions. But how were the lions catching it? Communities live right up against the outskirts of Serengeti National Park. And where there are people, there are dogs. Thousands of them. They were suspected as the source. Yet lions rarely come into contact with dogs, but they do mix with hyenas and jackals that scavenge near villages. It was these wild animals that provided the crucial link. Sick lions, forced out of their prides, became nomads, spreading canine distemper far and wide. It only took a few months for the virus to cross into Kenya's Masai Mara. An estimated 1,000 lions, a third of all the lions in the Serengeti Mara, were killed by the virus in a single year. The World Society for the Protection of Animals launched a massive campaign to vaccinate some 30,000 dogs and shut down the disease. Today, lion numbers in the Serengeti Mara have recovered and are back to previous levels. Canine distemper was brought under control, yet lion numbers across Africa have continued to decline. At the edge of the Masai Mara, there are clues to what's going on. As the human population has grown, settlements are squeezed right up to the edge of the park, and everyone is feeling the pressure. With pasture at a premium, Maasai graze their livestock on the border and even inside the park. Cattle are everything to the Maasai. They depend on them for a living, and they are a symbol of power and wealth.
Now, generally, lions, if they see people on foot, they just take off. They know from instinct that people and them, there's a problem, it's dangerous, move away.
Lions rarely attack humans. They're more occupied with hunting their natural prey, wildebeest and zebra. Thank you. But sometimes, an easy kill is just too tempting.
Now, this particular pride, the marsh pride, live right on the boundary of the reserve. So they spend some of their time in it, which is here. And if they were to walk literally 50 yards there, they would be outside the reserve. And it's a pretty straightforward rule. If the lions take livestock, then they are going to be killed. It's as simple as that. People and lions are incompatible. As the human population increases, conflict can only increase. And that has to be bad for an animal as big and potentially dangerous as a lion. During this last year, the marsh lions have been quite seriously impacted by conflict with the Maasai, and we've lost a number of adults, and that's really a very serious thing for the pride. We've lost at least 3 adult females. More recently, we've just lost one of the male lions that took over about a year ago in conflict situations with the Maasai, where the lions have taken cattle, the Maasai have responded and speared them. Do I blame the Maasai? No, I don't. They're not going to tolerate predators that overstep the mark. There's like a bargain. Leave us alone, no problem. Mess with our livestock, you're in trouble.
The recent killing of one of the marsh pride's ruling males has thrown the pride into turmoil. At least 2 males are needed to defend a pride. And if only 1 is left, the pride becomes a target for takeover by other gangs. Although many lions have been lost in the clash with people, in big parks like the Mara, there are enough lions for the population to bounce back. But half the lions left in Africa live in small, isolated pockets where the loss of a few could spell disaster. There is one such place that has already reached a crisis point. 6 hours' drive from the Masai Mara is Nairobi National Park, one of Kenya's smallest. When it opened in 1946, it was a comfortable distance from the capital. Today, it's about as close as you can get. Many lions once lived here, and visitors had a good chance of seeing them. These days, only 9 wild lions are left. Now, the best chance of seeing a Nairobi lion is in a zoo. The park lions live alongside humans, just like in the Mara. But here, the conflict is far more intense. Surrounded by the city, most of Nairobi National Park has had to be fenced, all except for the southern part, which has been left open to allow grazing animals to migrate in and out. In recent years, the game hasn't been returning, blocked by settlements and killed for bushmeat. As a result, starving lions have wandered into community areas where the trouble begins. Jim Cavanaugh, an American vet, has been monitoring the lions in the park for more than a decade.
These cats, they don't want to go outside the park. That's the last thing in the world they want to do. They want to stay here. They have territories here. They love to be in here. They know it's safe. They know nobody's going to hunt them. They know nobody's going to kill them. But when there's no food, what are they going to do? They're going to go out. They have to. And that's when they all get killed.
The community outside the park won't tolerate lions attacking their livestock. Over the last 5 years, some 50 lions have been killed in revenge attacks.
If they kill enough livestock out there, if they bother the people enough, they'll be killed. And once they're killed, they're finished. You can't restock it. What are you going to do? Bring in more lions? They're going to go out. It's just like fueling the fire, just slaughtering lions. You can't do that. My relationship with the lions has been so intimate that seeing them slaughtered and mutilated the way that they've been here, it's pretty devastating.
The lion killers are not ashamed of their actions. They are mainly individuals who live in the Kitengela area, a predominantly Maasai community south of the park.
We kill lions because they kill our animals, cows, sheep, and goats. We have lost very many, more than 300. This is a big problem. It has been there for a long time.
Lion killing goes back a long way. Maasai have lived side by side with their arch rival for centuries. Hunting them with spears was a fundamental Maasai tradition. A boy could not become a man until he had killed his first lion. Ole Kitanga was once a Maasai warrior and remembers the kudos of being a lion killer.
Killing a lion was an act of great pride and honor. It brought tremendous recognition in society.
These ritual hunts are now illegal in Kenya. But when livestock are killed, it's a different matter.
We've been killing lions since we are 17 years, 20 years old. Okay, we don't really want to kill the lion, but since they're eating our animals, we do it.
Some individuals have publicly sworn to kill all the remaining lions in the park. They are well on their way.
All of these cards here, and there are over 50 here, these are all on each individual lions that have been killed in Nairobi National Park over the years that I've been studying them. And most of them since 1998. There's been 52 lions killed from the park. This small stack here, are the only lions that are left in the park, and they're the only ones that I've identified over the last year in the park, and there are nine. This young lioness, I named her for my mom, and it was a big mistake because she was killed in the Kitengela too. She was only 2 years old when she was killed, and she and a young male lion were in the wrong place at the wrong time, apparently. But they had killed what their instinct tells them to. When you get a population that goes from this to this, you've got big trouble, because this is obviously going to be a very inbred group, and it leads to terrible complications for the lions.
One of the things we've got to accept is that the lion population in Africa now is becoming very fragmented. And the downside of that, long term, could be that you'll get inbreeding. You'll get animals that are related breeding with each other in these small, isolated populations. That's why it's so important to try and have large protected areas.
An inbred pride is more vulnerable to disease and fertility problems. That's when lion numbers can crash. To avoid this, you need a population of at least 100 breeding pairs. The future of the Nairobi Nine looks bleak. Nairobi National Park is just one example of what's going on all across Africa. Nearly half of all African lions live in isolated pockets and face the same fate. So what can be done to stop inbreeding and to widen the gene pool? Sometimes lions are moved from one park to another, but translocation is tricky and often ends in disaster. Lions protect their land with all their might. Newcomers risk injury, even death. A more controversial way of introducing new blood to isolated prides is through artificial insemination. Some scientists believe that this could be the way forward. Paul Bartels, a vet from the Wildlife Biological Resource Center in Johannesburg, is confident that his lion sperm bank could help save the lion.
We've been collecting sperm from lion donors for the last 4 or 5 years, and in fact, that's what our project does. We collect biomaterials from wild populations and keep them as an insurance policy for the future. In order to collect lion sperm, first of all, from live animals, they are darted. So we immobilize them, because you certainly don't want to be working with an awake lion when you collect sperm from him. We have to be obviously very careful. If the drug hasn't worked properly, he can still jump up and grab. It has happened once before. Do have an injury from a lion. I was extremely lucky, but he did grab my arm.
The lion is deeply sedated, but the clock is ticking. Dr. Bartels has only a matter of minutes to collect the sperm before the lion wakes up.
Okay, so one of the first things we want to do is look at this guy's important part, which is the testes.
A short blast of electricity is all it takes. Dr. Bartels' lion sperm bank already has samples from 25 lions, but he hopes to collect 1,000 samples over the next couple of years and inject this genetic diversity into isolated prides.
And you don't have to do it too often. That's the beauty about it. You only have to filter in genes every 12 to 15 years within a particular isolated lion population. So it's not the kind of, you're not going to see guys driving around with white coats and these pickups, you know, all equipped and artificially inseminating all lion. That's not going to happen.
The program is just beginning, but hopefully the sperm and tissue samples that are being collected will be a lifeline for lions if they do become critically endangered. And if the situation gets really desperate, there's the possibility of cloning.
God help us if we have to use cloning one day for the lion. Which is outrageous. The thought is outrageous, but the point is that if a specifically an animal's numbers crashes dramatically, there is that potential that we could produce one animal from one cell line, and if we have thousands of cell lines with a lot of gene diversity, maybe bring them back one day.
Already in India, scientists are planning to use cloning to help save the dwindling Asian lion population from extinction. There are fewer than 300 left. If steps aren't taken, the African lion's future could become equally precarious.
This problem can only get worse over time, so we have to start thinking now of protecting gene diversity. That's the bottom line.
But are high-tech solutions really the answer? Thank you. Surely it's better to prevent lions from becoming isolated by allowing them to roam free. But to do this, we'd have to tackle the biggest threat to lions, conflict with humans. Elaine Matheson works for the Wildlife Conservation Society's Lykipia Predator Project, trying to help big cats and humans coexist. The project is monitoring the prides that live in the vast Lykipia district in northern Kenya. With 200 lions roaming over land used both by commercial ranchers and traditional Maasai herders, they've got their work cut out for them. Each year, 1 in 5 lions is shot. Even more are poisoned or speared.
We've collected these skulls over the years, and actually we've got quite a few entire skeletons as well. And this is a male who was shot in the head. You can see the bullet wound there, for killing cattle. He ate one too many cows. This one was actually a member of an entire pride that was poisoned. The poison was probably meant for hyena rather than lion and put down by members of the local community, but actually the whole pride ate it and died, which was very sad. This one was also shot, not in the head, but a body shot, that one, again for killing livestock.
Lawrence Frank, the director of the Lykipia Predator Project, has been studying the lions here for 8 years.
What's killing lions is people killing them in defense of livestock, full stop. The point of the Lykipia Predator Project is to learn how lions and other predators manage to live under severe human pressure and how we can change human behavior in realistic, feasible manners in order to tolerate large carnivores living among them.
But as lions continue to be killed, the Predator Project team is in a race against time. They're trying to radio collar as many lions as possible to learn more about their movements and what they eat.
We've got two brothers here, and the one's got a collar already, but I need to get a collar on the second brother in case they split up, and then I always know where both of them are.
Elaine first has to dart the lion with a sedative.
He's a very handsome boy. Yeah. Yes. Good. Good.
Once the lion is out for the count, blood samples are taken. Okay. They'll be sent off for disease analysis. Elaine gives him a full exam, from his testicles to his teeth.
You can see he's got very nice teeth. I reckon he's about 4 years old. Upper canine, 0.2 height. Yeah. He's just snoring because we've been moving his windpipe around a bit.
Last but not least, this lion gets fitted with a new radio collar and joins nearly 100 lions in the Lykipia area, which have already been fitted.
At the moment, we're trying to get as many collars on in the area and trying to find out if there's a, you know, some prides that tend to take livestock a lot more than other prides. And if so, why are those prides taking livestock and other prides aren't?
Some patterns are already emerging. Single lions are more of a problem, either lone females or inexperienced young males. But occasionally, whole prides just develop a taste for livestock. This is a real problem, as it seems mothers pass this habit on to their cubs. Every night, livestock owners corral their sheep and cattle in walled or thornbush enclosures called bomas. but lions can be very determined. After dark is when they're most likely to strike. Traditional cattle herders tend to be zero tolerant of lion kills. They simply can't afford to lose a single animal. But commercial ranchers can bear the odd loss. They're more willing to give lions a second chance.
Here in Laikipia, nearly all the commercial ranchers are very pro-wildlife and pro-conservation. I don't know anywhere in the world outside of Laikipia where people are raising livestock commercially and tolerating a significant population of these large livestock-eating predators. Everywhere else, they've killed them off.
Klaus Mortensen manages a 45,000-acre ranch with thousands of livestock, abundant wildlife, and a tourist lodge. Klaus is willing to let lions roam freely on his land for the sake of tourists and conservation. But there is a limit to what he'll tolerate.
Once a lion really gets a taste for the easy prey like livestock, they will become habitual killers. And you'll find they will just stop going for the wild prey out there and come in and try and get the livestock. To catch sheep or the goats, they will simply jump over the wall, grab one animal, and jump out with it. Whereas with the cattle, they would jump in, and the cattle being so big and strong, they would stampede and they'd break through the gate and then run into the dark of the night, where they would go out and nab one of them.
An attack here or there is forgiven. But when a lion becomes a serial killer and the losses start to mount, the mood hardens.
The recent lioness named Isabella, whom we knew very well, she left the pride, started going by herself, and then she'd come in here every night and take one sheep or whatever. And eventually she totaled, I think, 65 sheep. Now that was a huge loss. But it was also very difficult to decide when to remove her. We tried many things to stop her from coming in. Like we would put up electric wire above the stone walls in the back where she used to come in from. She then became more clever and started coming in from the front. We had to fire shots over her at night when we saw her coming in, chase her with the car. We actually also caught her in a cage trap and then gave her the exposure with all the people, women, children coming around and banging at the cage. It gave her a real trauma about coming near human beings and livestock. But something in her just made it compulsory that she had to carry on and carry on killing. And unfortunately, we had to take her out. And by taking her out, I mean shoot her.
Not all the lions here will become offenders. But the Predator Project is encouraging all ranchers and herders to take precautions. Whether bomas are built with acacia thorns or stone, they need to be robust, high-walled, and dense. As a second line of defense, they should be guarded by people and dogs. If you have enough money, you can create a maximum security facility.
This boma here has been designed on a commercial ranch where there's a large population of lion, and it's probably as close to 100% lion-proof as you're ever likely to get. It's a double stone wall, and between the two stone walls is earth, and in the earth is planted this cactus, which when it grows up will be an impenetrable barrier.
Sadly, not everyone can afford a lion-proof super boma, so lions are still killing and being killed.
I'm following up on a mortality signal that I've got from one of my collared lions. basically, when the collar doesn't move for a period of time, it gives off a different signal, which normally indicates the lion is dead, but sometimes the collar falls off. So we're going to go and follow the signal in and see if the lion is dead, and if it is dead, try and work out what killed it.
Elaine's fears are confirmed. One of her lions is dead.
You can smell the carcass, but there's hardly anything left. Oh, lion claw. Oh, his mane. Mane. It's a male lion. Very often, all you get left is mane. Scavengers finish off all the remains very quickly. There's mane all around here. Here's his collar. He's got a frequency. He's one of a group of, a coalition of three males that we collared about 2 months ago. It's always a shame when you lose such a prime young male. There's a good chance it's poison. They're really worthless vermin to the surrounding landowners. They have no value and they kill cattle and get killed, so that's a shame.
I think that anybody can live with lions if they have the financial motivation to do so. As it is, you can get rid of your lion problem with a few pennies worth of poison. We in the West often seem to think that we can come to the third world with our sentimental attachment to wildlife and just tell people that they should love the wild animals as much as we do. But if the wild animals are trampling your crops or eating your livestock or occasionally stepping on you, this sentimental love of wildlife means nothing. It comes down to giving people the financial motivation, and I'm afraid it must be financial, to put in the effort to live with wildlife. That means wildlife has to, in some way, enhance their standard of living significantly.
Some people have found a way of giving lions a financial value, but not everybody agrees with it.
I'm with you. 20 chocolate.
Simon Evans runs camel safaris for tourists in northern Kenya. But he can't rely on tourism alone to keep his business afloat. The only way he can make ends meet is by spending half his year leading a completely different life as a professional hunter.
I enjoy hunting because it's a challenge for me. I like the little, the risk involved. You're in his environment. The animal has got maybe just as equal a chance of getting you as you are of him. It's just like any other sport. People do dangerous sports because they get an adrenaline rush. It's what keeps me going, gives me a kick.
You know, as a kid, I was brought up on a farm. I used to love to go out with an air rifle and stalk up on game. I understand the excitement of the hunter within me. That's our heritage. That's what we used to do. But hunting just for the sheer pleasure of it, going out and killing a lion or a leopard, I would just love to get the hunter and give them quality time watching a lion that I've known since it was a cub and let them absorb that sense of that creature, the living being. Because what happens? A hunter goes out and shoots an animal that they don't know anything about.
Hunting is banned in Kenya, so Simon operates as a guide for wealthy hunters in countries where it is allowed.
Cameroon, South Africa, Zambia now is opened. Congo has just opened hunting. Tanzania has been hunting for a while. Ethiopia is open for lion. I think Mozambique. Namibia. I think those are pretty much the main countries, yeah, that I know of.
Hunting lion is big business.
It's going to cost them, there'll probably be no change at the end of the day out of $50,000 to $60,000 to get a big lion.
With such a high price on a lion's head, could the revenue from trophy hunting help save them?
Hunters, in my opinion, are very much conservationists. We're not trying to reduce numbers, because it's our future. I do believe that the population of lions would increase if there was a value to them. The people would then look after them, turn around and say, that animal is worth $30,000, $40,000, whatever, $1,000 to us. You've got to look at it like that animal you've taken is now going to go back into the system to save the rest of them.
Although many of us find the idea of killing an animal for fun to be very distasteful, there are a lot of people in the world who will pay large amounts of money for the opportunity to shoot a lion or a buffalo or an elephant. That money can potentially drastically change the perception of rural Africans if it brings an improvement in their standard of living. But you must keep in mind that in order to produce a few big old trophy males, you need a vast ecosystem full of wildlife to support the populations that will ultimately produce those old trophy males.
We've just seen a lion run by in these bushes over here. He was crouching and creeping through the bush. We're gonna try and get up on him and see if he's a takeable lion, whether he's big enough and he's got a decent enough mane. He looked quite nice from a distance.
The best trophy lions have the biggest manes. The mane says everything about a lion. It's a status symbol and a turn-on. Not just for lionesses. For the hunters, too. And there's the rub. The lions hunters want to shoot are the ones most likely to be ruling a pride. So the repercussions of removing just one lion can be disastrous. If the pride males get shot, the lionesses have to fend for themselves until another gang takes over. The new males will kill any small cubs and sire their own. It's catastrophic for lionesses. And if too many adult males are shot, younger, inexperienced ones with barely a mane are left to rule the pride. It's like letting a bunch of teenagers run the country. Researchers in Tanzania have proposed a method of hunting which they believe won't reduce lion numbers. They recommend hunters should only shoot males over 5 years old, an age when most have already raised cubs. One way of telling a lion's age is by the color of its nose. The blacker the nose, the older the lion. A fully mature 5-year-old has a nose at least 50% black. The only problem is you might not always get a glimpse of the lion's nose. So hunters need to know their lions to guess their age.
That's a beautiful lion, but he's got another year or two, and he's gonna be a very suitable lion. It'd be a mistake to shoot that lion now because he's fully into his breeding. His mane is fairly well developed, but it'll grow. It's still gonna grow, and it's probably gonna darken. And his face is a young face. I would say my guess is about 4 year old. And in a year or two, he's gonna be a really beautiful lion. So we're not gonna take him now.
And I can understand the fact that you can create an argument for hunting as a source of revenue to pay for wildlife. Personally, I don't like it, but I'm willing to be convinced, if it can be proven, that it will help preserve wild land. And I think there are situations in which it can.
Although it may be hard to understand why anyone would want to shoot such a magnificent beast, trophy hunting could help lions pay their way in hard-up rural communities. But would these communities actually reap the rewards? Can such a lucrative industry be strictly controlled? Or would hunting simply add to the lion's problems? This area of northern Kenya used to be lawless and rife with poachers. But these young Maasai entrepreneurs have taken the law into their own hands and have put an end to poaching. The lions now have more value alive than dead. Jonathan Kipp is the manager of this award-winning Maasai-run tourist lodge called Ilingwesi, the first of its kind in Kenya.
We are very lucky to have lions because that will attract more guests. And the more we get the guests, the more revenue we get from the tourism.
At $240 a night, this wilderness lodge is about luxury. But you can splurge knowing it's for a good cause. 40% of the fee goes to the 6,000 residents in the community. In exchange for a cut of the profits, they promise to protect wildlife and prevent poaching.
In the morning, you would see lions and other game walking around. And especially the view from the loo is brilliant.
Most of the tourists that stay here want to see lions. But the 20 lions in the area can get a little too close for comfort.
This hill used to be a hideout for lions. And after building the rooms, our guests used to see the footprints of lions touring around the place at night. And most of them were scared and worried about the lions, and we had to put those doors for the safety of guests.
To keep tabs on the three local prides, one lion from each pride is radio collared. Tracking them in this way isn't just helpful for tourists. It also helps ensure the cats aren't causing trouble.
Sometimes they go and attack the cattle out there. But since we've collared some, we have our rangers. And every day, and sometimes even nighttime, they make sure they try to follow up and find where they are. In case they do attack the cattle, we know at least which pride did that.
Ole Kitanga, a Maasai elder from this community, has had to kill many lions to protect his livestock. One encounter was particularly dramatic.
I ran down this way and spared the lion as he pinned down my cow. He jumped up and tried to bite me. I held him by his mouth and fought him with all my strength. I suffered these injuries on my hand and arm.
Scarred for life, he is still willing to make peace with his enemy.
The local people are tolerant with them because we are benefiting direct from them. We normally say we are milking. It's like a cow. You're milking a lion in the wild because tourists come, they take pictures, they see them very happy, and they give us money. So the members are very tolerant to the lions.
He may have been a Maasai warrior and lion slayer, but Ole Kitanga is now on the board of Ilingwesi's conservation project. He's willing to tolerate lions if he can benefit financially.
We don't kill lions anymore because they are beneficial to us. The profits from the tourist lodge provide us with money to educate our children and pesticides to protect our cattle. Most of our problems have been solved thanks to the lion.
Ilingwesi's conservation plan has successfully encouraged the community to value and protect their wildlife.
I would like other people to come up with such an idea like we have. If other communities in Africa would copy these, I'm sure there will be safety for the lions.
What does the future hold for lions? Outside of wildlife parks, it seems clear they will only be able to roam wild if they are of value to people. Positive initiatives like Ilingwesi that encourage community conservation deserve support. But in less scenic areas and where tourism is unreliable, will Africans turn to more controversial solutions? Many people disagree on the solutions to living with lions, but there's no debate that lions need our protection. And they need space to roam freely.
I simply can't imagine the Maasai Mara without wild lions. And for as long as you've got areas such as this which are protected, then I think there's a future for lions. Given the chance, they can breed like rabbits. And so their ability to actually repopulate an area is enormous.
Lions are living in difficult times when even kings must find a way to earn their keep. As tourist attraction or trophy, they must compete for a place in our world. Ultimately, it's their ability to impress us that holds their kingdom together.